you said, Father, we will confess our sins, that you are faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
We ask for your forgiveness today, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
That you cleanse us from all unrighteousness today, Father. Holy Spirit, speak through this my vessel. Father God, decrease me and increase in me more and more, Father. In the name of Jesus, as Lord God, we've come to hear a word from you.
Yes, yes.
We've come to hear a word from you, Lord. And Father, we thank you for your presence in this house today, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, for those that are tuned in, Father, even over the social media, Father. Touch those lives, Father, that have not surrendered to you, Lord God. Touch those lives, Father, that have not accepted Jesus as their Lord and Savior. We stand in the gap for them today.
Hallelujah.
In the name of Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Father, we know that the Lord's return is soon.
Yes. Yes.
And Father, we want to be ready.
Hallelujah.
And God, we want as many to go with us as possible, Father. So, Father God, we will not shut our mouths.
Yes,
Lord. We will declare and decree your word. We will testify of your goodness. We will invite others to taste and see that you are good, oh God. In the name of Jesus, we will let our light shine brightly before men, that they may see our good works and glorify you, Father. In the name of Jesus. God, we thank you, Lord God, for the dwelling of your Holy Spirit. We thank you, Lord God, that he's a helper, Father. That he keeps us in the midst of chaos, oh God. That he leads us and guides us into all truth and understanding. Father, we thank you, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. And God, we give you all the praise, all the glory, all the honor, all the adoration that you deserve, oh God. We will not give your praise to another, Father. We will not give your love to another, Lord God, because it's only you, Father, that keeps us, oh God. You are the restorer of our souls. In the name of Jesus. God, we thank you today. In Jesus' name. Amen. And amen, amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. It's a blessing to see Elder King in the house. Amen. I have not seen him in a few years. Praise God. It's a blessing to have you here. Amen. Amen. Truly, God is good, and he is worthy to be praised. And I'm going to be up here and give what God has given me to give. And when I finish giving what he's given me to give, I'm going to move out of his way. Amen. Amen. So I was asking the Lord, I said, Lord, what is it that we need to hear? What is it that we need to hear? Amen. So the Lord said that his people, that we need to quiet our soul. We need to quiet our soul. And what is our soul? Our soul is our mind, our will, and our emotions, because we can allow our emotions to get the best of us.
Amen.
You know, situations can occur, and before you know it, the stress level is up, and we're responding to that stress. We're not sleeping at night. Our minds are not settling down. We can't rest at night because they're constantly turning. But the Lord says, my people need to quiet their soul.
Yes, sir. Yes.
And Charles Stanley said, we need to learn to listen for the voice of God.
That's right.
Before trouble comes. Because when trouble comes, you've got all this pressure. And you can't hear what you need to hear. So Lord, teach us to hear your voice with clarity in good times.
That's right.
Train us, Lord, to hear your voice, to hear what your spirit is saying to the church in these last and evil days in good times. So that way is when trouble comes, God, I know I can recognize your voice because there's so much noise around us. So much noise around us. We're hearing from our supervisors. We're hearing from our families. We're hearing from coworkers. We're hearing the news. We're hearing all this pressure, the status of our employment, what needs to occur on the job. Somebody's waiting for that doctor to call with the diagnosis. The bill that's due and you don't have the money for it. The well-being of your children is so much clamoring for our attention. But what voices are we hearing? What voices are we hearing? And the Lord is saying, quiet your soul so that I can speak to you. Because if I'm revved up, I can't hear from God. You think about a baby that's hungry. And you have the bottle ready. But they're screaming to the top of their lungs. You're trying to stick it in there, and they're still screaming.
not realizing the need that they have is being met if they would just settle down.
That's right.
And the Lord is telling us we need to settle down.
Amen.
Because we're allowing the pressure from the world to take our focus off of Him. And God said, you've got to keep your focus on me. We just sing that song, Great is Your Faithfulness. God met the needs of His people years ago. He's still meeting our needs today. He's still a miracle worker. He's still a way maker. He's still a restorer of our souls.
Amen.
So we can't allow the pressure from the world to get to us, that we can't hear the voice of God. Amen?
Amen.
So let's start off in 1 Kings chapter 17. Because the enemy tried to tell us, what are you going to do? Minister Dominique, what are you going to do when that deadline comes? What are you going to do if that job shuts down? What are you going to do if they give you a notice that you're fired? What are you going to do when the doctor gives your diagnosis? But the Lord is saying, you've got to trust Him. We've got to trust in God. The just shall live by faith.
Amen. Amen.
The just shall live by faith. And people say, you know, and I think I've said it myself before, you've got to, you know, your faith is like a muscle that you've got to work out. But really, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So your faith grows when you're in the word of God and you're reading His word, reading about His promises, reading about His faithfulness. Your faith can't help but grow.
Amen. Amen.
But what happens if we're not in the word of God? Because the Lord says, I have given every man a measure of faith.
Yes,
yes. So now, if Minister Tony is in his word 10 hours throughout the week, and you're only in your word 1 hour, and you see miracles being performed in his life, don't be jealous. Because he has made an intentional decision that he is going to spend time in the word of God, that he's not going to allow himself to be distracted.
Amen.
And we've got to have a made-up mind today. We have to have a made-up mind today that God, nothing is going to come between me and spending time with you. I am going to foster this relationship.
Hallelujah.
I'm going to spend time in your presence. I'm going to spend time in my prayer closet. I'm going to spend time reading my word.
Yeah.
And just like Brandon was sharing with me yesterday, he says, Mom, what I do now, sometimes I just put it on YouTube and have the word playing so that I'm still hearing it.
Amen.
Even if I can't physically pick up my Bible, let me put the word on. We spend so much time on reality TV and all these shows, and I'm a movie addict, so I have to watch how many movies I consume. So it's like, Lord, I got to turn this TV off. And I've got to saturate myself in your word. And that's what we need to get back to. We need to saturate ourselves in the word of God, because that's how our faith grows. Because then when the enemy is coming at us with all of these emotions and all of these feelings and all of these thoughts and all of these imaginations, if you haven't been in the word of God, how are you going to cast it down? But the word of God says to cast down imaginations and every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God, bring into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. So God, where is my focus at today? Where is my mind at today? What am I thinking on today? And we all have troubles. We all have trials. I believe if I gave this mic to everyone in here, you could tell me something that's going on in your life today.
Amen.
But you cannot let it stop you from praising God. You cannot let it steal your focus. You cannot be so consumed with it that you're not hearing from the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
So 1 Kings chapter 17. So we got a little bit of reading today. And it says, now Elijah, and I'm reading from the New Living Translation. Now Elijah, who was from Tishbe in Gilead, told King Ahab, as surely as the Lord, the God of Israel, lives, the God I serve, there will be no dew or rain during the next few years until I give the word. Then the Lord said to Elijah, go to the east and hide by Kerith Brook, near where it enters the Jordan River. Drink from the brook and eat what the ravens bring you, for I have commanded them to bring you food. So Elijah did as the Lord told him and camped beside Kerith Brook, east of the Jordan. The ravens brought him bread and meat each morning and evening, and he drank from the brook. But after a while, the brook dried up, for there was no rainfall anywhere in the land. So right there, it shows you Elijah's commitment to God. Because first of all, the Lord told him what to do, and he did it. How many of us, God tells us to do something, and we question Him? Well, God, can you confirm it? Again and again and again. Instead of saying, God, I trust you and I'm going to be, but you know what happens? And you know why we question him? Because we doubt what we've heard. Because our soul is so revved up. We're caught up in our emotions. We're caught up in what's going on. We're caught up in the news and what's going on. And before you know it, we're in a panic and God is trying to tell us to do something. God, is that you? Are you sure that's what you want me to do? Are you sure you want me to help feed this family? When we know that God is, that he gives us instruction. Amen. Amen? And we're to be obedient. So the Lord told Elijah the word to give to Ahab. And then he told him, don't go hide yourself. And I'm going to send the ravens to feed you. So you think about the times that we're living in now. Don't be afraid about what you're going to eat and what you're going to drink, because your God is your source. And he's going to take care of his children. Amen? That's why it behooves us to have a quiet soul that we can hear the instruction of the Lord. But if I'm so focused on this issue in my life, then I'm going to miss what God is trying to tell me on this side. Amen? So it's like, Lord, I got to get my focus back on you. Get my emotions lined up with your word and trust you and just be obedient to everything that God tells us to do. Amen?
Amen.
So the Lord said, go, the ravens are going to feed you. Now, Elijah could have started complaining when the brook dried up. But then the Lord spoke to Elijah again. He says, now, then the Lord said to Elijah, go and live in the village of Zarephath near the city of Sidon. I have instructed a widow there to feed you. So he went to Zarephath. As he arrived at the gates of the village, he saw a widow gathering sticks, and he asked her, would you please bring me a little water in a cup? As she was going to get it, he called to her, bring me a bite of bread too. But she said, I swear by the Lord your God that I don't have a single piece of bread in the house, and I have only a handful of flour left in the jar and a little cooking oil in the bottom of the jug. I was just gathering a few sticks to cook this last meal, and then my son and I will die. But Elijah said to her, don't be afraid. Go ahead and do just what you've said, but make a little bread for me first. Then use what's left to prepare a meal for yourself and your son. For this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. There will always be flour and olive oil left in your containers until the time when the Lord sends rain and the crops grow again. So she did as Elijah said, and she and Elijah and her family continued to eat for many days. There was always enough flour and enough olive oil left in the containers, just as the Lord had promised through Elijah. Amen. That's the God we serve today. So just as he made that promise to that widow woman in Zarephath, he's making a promise to us today.
Yes, ma'am.
That you're not going to go hungry. That you're not going to go naked. That you're going to have shelter over your head if you trust him and believe. Stop looking at what they're saying. Stop being moved by these situations that we're in. And remember who is on the throne. We say that God is sovereign. He is supreme. It is his voice that's in the land. It doesn't matter who's in the White House or who's over our local government. What is God saying to us? What is God saying to us? And God is saying that you can trust him.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
Let's look at Isaiah 26, verse 3. Because this is where the battlefield is. It's in our mind.
Yes, it is.
Amen.
Bringing those thoughts captive. Amen? But the word of God says in Isaiah 26, verse 3, he says, you will keep in perfect peace all who trust in you, all whose thoughts are fixed on you.
Amen.
Where are your thoughts fixed at today? What is consuming your thoughts today? We say we come into the house of the Lord to give him praise and worship. But where was your mind at during praise and worship?
Amen.
Are you thinking about the situations?
Amen.
Are you thinking about what's going to occur after church? Are you thinking about what's going to happen tomorrow when you go to work? Or are your focus fixed on, Lord, I've come to worship you.
Mm-hmm.
I've come to praise you. Lord God, I've come to minister to you today.
Amen.
I'm not asking you for anything because you already know what I have need of.
Yes.
So I want to bring that sacrifice of praise. I want to press beyond my feelings. I want to press beyond my situations.
Yes.
I want to press beyond my circumstances.
Yes.
And I want to bring God the best praise that I can bring him. Amen?
Amen.
So he will keep you in perfect peace, those who trust in him and whose mind is stayed on him. And that's not saying that you don't have times where your mind may drift, but you have to immediately yank it back in.
Yeah.
And I'm going to be the first one to be transparent. So I'm on the way to church, right? I be having all kinds of thoughts going through my head. And I'm like, okay, Lord, I had my music on. But then I was like, you know what, God? It's going to be 4 years, y'all. 4 years this year. And Brandon had told me that Elder King was at Deshaun's game. But when I thought about him, I started crying. Because I remembered how much Pastor loved him. And it's like, okay, Lord. So then I'm on 408, you know, waterworks about to start. I was like, okay, wait a minute. I gotta reel this back in, Lord. You know, because God, you've been so faithful. God, you've been so faithful. You have kept us in the midst of it all. You kept us, Lord. You know, you supply all of our needs. And it's like, God, I can't do anything but praise you. Do I miss him every day? But God, I thank you for the time that you gave us. I thank you, Lord God, for the legacy that he has left. Because it was this Sunday, it was like the October the 8th, that was his last Sunday bringing the word to us. I remember what he had on and everything. I have such a vivid memory. Sometimes it's not good. Because sometimes it's stuff I shouldn't be remembering.
Amen.
But it is like, Lord, I got to give it to you. I have to surrender to God. I have to bring it to him. It's like, Lord, you got to get me in check now. You know, and I was getting dressed. And I'm going to brag on myself. I said, you know what? I don't look like no widow. I'm looking good today. Amen. Because God is good. I don't have to have a heavy heart. Amen. I don't have to have a heavy heart. God, I thank you, Lord. So we've got to keep our praise. Regardless of what we're going through, saints. Regardless of the pressure that we're going through. Let's look at Romans chapter 8, verses 35 through 39. We can't stop praising God just because of precious heart. Look at Brother Jorge.
Come on.
Look at Brother Jorge. And look how God has kept him through all the surgeries. What was it? 5 surgeries in 3 months. We would have 1 surgery and be about to ready to lose our mind. But look at the faithfulness of God. And how can you not give God praise? Because he is a healer. He is a restorer. He is a deliverer. Amen? So Romans chapter 8, starting at verse 35 says, can anything ever separate us from Christ's love? Does it mean he no longer loves us if we have trouble or calamity or are persecuted or hungry or destitute or in danger or threatened with death? As the scriptures say, for your sake we are killed every day. We are being slaughtered like sheep. No, despite all these things, overwhelming victory is ours through Christ who loved us.
Hallelujah.
And the word of God says, and I am convinced that nothing can ever separate us from God's love. Neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither our fears for today nor our worries about tomorrow, not even the powers of hell can separate us from God's love. No power in the sky above or in the earth below. Indeed, nothing in all creation will ever be able to separate us from the love of God that is revealed in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Amen.
Who are you going to believe today?
Amen.
What voice are you going to listen to today?
Amen.
Who are you going to follow today? We are going to follow the word of the Lord.
Yes.
Because the word of God is truth. And it is his truth that pierces the darkness of the world that we live in.
Amen.
It pierces the darkness in our souls.
Thank you,
we're not talking about our spirit, man. We're talking about our soul. When we entertain things that we shouldn't have. And then it's like, God, I need the truth of your word to pierce this darkness. To pierce through this worry, to pierce through this anxiety, to pierce through these fears. Because God, you did not give us a spirit of fear, but you gave us a power, love, and of a sound mind. And let's look at Joshua 1:9. And I love this verse because, you know, when Joshua took over from Moses, after Moses, and the Lord said to him, this is my command. Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid or discouraged. For the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. So wherever you go, don't be afraid, don't be discouraged, because God is with you wherever you go. You may stand to your feet. We serve a good God. We serve a God that can't fail. He has never failed us and he never will.
Hallelujah.
But we've got to take the limits off of God.
Yes, ma'am.
We've got to take God out of this box that we put him in.
Because
we always want to know how you're going to do it, Lord, and when you're going to do it, and who you're going to do it through. And God says, that's not your business. What your business is to trust me. That I'm going to provide every need that you have. That I'm going to supply all of your needs according to my riches and glory in Christ Jesus. That's what God is saying in his word. That I'm going to take care of you. Regardless of what the job says, regardless of the doctor's report, regardless of the prognosis, God says, I am with you. Wherever you go. The Lord says, if I make my bed in hell, he's with me. There is no place that God can't go with me. And when we're living in this chaotic life that we're living in, still dealing with this pandemic, and all of these mandates they're trying to force on us, God, you're with me wherever I go. And you would have to trust that and believe that. That God is with you, that he's going to meet every last one of your needs. Every last one of your needs. Brianna is here. Didn't know how she was going to get to college. But look at how God is providing for her. It doesn't matter whether it's through those. God can move however he wants to. But are you going to take the limits off of him? So that he can move. The people couldn't accept Jesus because it was like, that's Joseph's son. They didn't see him as their deliverer. They wanted to see this king riding in on this white horse. But the Lord sent him in the form of a baby to live a life so that he could be that example for us that we can go through. There is nothing that God is bringing to your door that he has not already equipped you to handle. And I'm speaking to myself.
Amen.
There is nothing that he is bringing to your door he's not already equipped you to handle.
Amen.
Will you trust him?
Yes.
Will you saturate yourself in his word?
Yes.
So that your faith can grow.
Yes.
Stop listening to all these other voices. People always have an opinion. People always have an opinion. What you should or shouldn't do. What is God saying to you? And if you say that you can't hear him, then you need to quiet your soul so that you can hear the voice of the Lord.
Amen.
Father, in the name of Jesus, we your people come to say thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for filling us with your spirit. Thank you, Lord God, for leading us in this life. Thank you, Lord God, for equipping us with every spiritual blessing. And Father God, we ask right now in the name of Jesus. And Lord God, that you continue to keep your hand upon us. Move, and we will not be shaken by the things that we see occurring in the land, oh God. Because you are our source, Father. You've already declared that you will supply all of our needs according to your riches and glory in Christ Jesus. And that is what we stand on, oh God. And we thank you, Lord God, because you're not man. So you can't lie. God, you're the same yesterday, today, and forever. And God, we trust you today. We will not let our praise be hindered. We will not let our worship be hindered. We will not let our joy be taken. We will not lose our peace, oh God. Because it's solidified in you, Lord, in the name of Jesus. You are our peace. Your joy is our strength today. In the name of Jesus. Thank you for your hedge of protection, oh God. Thank you how you lead us by your spirit, Father. Lord God, we thank you right now, Father. We cannot give you enough praise and enough worship, oh God, because we don't want no rocks crying out for us. We want to praise you, Lord, with all of our being, oh God. And we thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen and amen.